Hello. Welcome. And thank you so much to all of the Creative Mornings team and to Molly. We just had so much fun setting up last night. Probably it was illegal how much fun we had. And I just appreciate and respect all of you so much. You're all such talented people. So thank you for this. And welcome to Atomic Object, where I'm going to talk about compassion today and all the warm fuzzies that come with that. And I'm really excited that we're having this at AO on a Friday, because of late, during our daily stand-ups, where we meet in here every weekday at 10 a.m., and everyone shares announcements and things. And lately, on Fridays, the announcements have had this kind of happy, cool undertone to them. In my mind, I've been calling them Good Feel Fridays. So I want to kick off today with a good feel, and that is to say, happy 60th birthday to my mother. Today is her birthday. And everyone knows her as Lady. So on the count of three, can we all say, happy birthday, Lady? So one, two, three. Happy birthday, Lady. Woohoo! All right, so let's get started. I'm Kim, or Kimberly, as Molly said. I go by either. And I am a designer here at Atomic Object. And I'm really excited because next year I celebrate 10 years as being a full-time professional designer. And I've had a blast thinking about what my last 10 have looked like and what the next 10 ahead might be. So I've also been a Grand Rapidian since 2002 when I started as a Grand Valley Laker. And All right. So I'm going to speak today about compassion and how I've learned it in my life, but recognize that there are a lot of really more highly qualified people to talk about compassion. So today I humbly present to you my take on compassion and hope that after this talk is over, you think about what compassion means to you in your life. So today I'm going to talk to you about how I learned compassion in my personal life, how then I integrated it into volunteerism, and then also how we weave compassion into the work we do here at Atomic. So because for me, compassion is learned, I think, much like love and hate can sometimes be learned. And fortunately, I've been privileged to have so many excellent role models and family and friends and teachers and coaches and more, and I'm going to introduce you to some of those people today. So there's a second layer to this as well, and it's how it describes how a professor taught me how to listen, how good role models and friends in our local design community taught me how to take action, and then how I weave those teachings and compassion into the work we do here at Atomic. So the simple gist today, the lesson, is listening plus action equals compassion. I know that probably doesn't make sense yet, but hopefully it will. So all of this, for me, sits in on a foundation of fun, because there are so many serious and sad and anger-inducing reasons to get involved in something and to act compassionately. But compassion doesn't always have to be this big, heavy emotion. For me, it's about bringing a little bit of light to a dark corner, to laugh when everything might be going wrong, to create a little something from nothing, to nevertheless persist, and to have a blast while doing it. So let's kick off part one, where I'm going to talk about the first real steps that I took towards understanding and learning compassion. And the concept for this part is really simple. It revolves around listening. So let's dive in. And the story that I'm going to tell you today starts with a high five. So I want everyone to look to your neighbor and very enthusiastically give them a high five. Do it, go, woo, get them up. All right, woohoo, these are good. These are, thank you. Whew. Good Feel Friday, man. Good Feel Friday. It's happening. All right, so that is how I met my friend Minna, with a high five. That was the first action we took together, is I high-fived her. And for me, learning compassion really started with Minna. She made me think about life and volunteerism in ways that I had never thought of before. Minna was an x-ray technician and a nurse and a comedian and a world traveler and the best dancer I'd ever met, and she dedicated her entire life to volunteerism. And she was one of my greatest friends, and on the very first day that I met her, she was 96 years old. So let's rewind a little bit. How did I meet Minna? And it's my sophomore year at Grand Valley, where I'm studying illustration and graphic design. in my illustration professor assigns our end of the year project, and it is to go to a local assisted living facility called Lincoln Square in Standale and meet with one of the residents, interview them, and then based off of the stories that you hear, create a series of illustrations. And I remember this lesson really well because during it he said, listen to them. Take the time to develop really good questions that will help them remember their best stories. Don't make this about you and ramble on about yourself. Really take the time to listen to them. Your illustrations will reflect how well you've listened. And it was by chance that I was paired with Minna, and we just instantly hit it off. And we spent the whole day together, and I was interviewing her and taking source photography. And what I'm gonna show you next, I'm gonna talk about the story of her life as she told it to me. You're gonna see some of the source photography that I took that day. And then you'll see two of the illustrations that I made for that end of the year project. I don't have the whole set anymore because she actually had the rest of them. I drew the outline of the illustrations and then Minna colored them in. So I present to you the story of Minna. Minna was born in 1908 in the Netherlands, and 2 years after that, her family immigrated to America and they moved to Holland, Michigan. And Minna never really told me much about her younger years. Her story always started with me when she became an army nurse that was stationed in Honolulu. And it's there that she meets Dave. And this is Dave. And Dave was the love of her life. And they become engaged. And on the morning of December 7th, 1941, Minna wanted to pack a lunch for Dave. So she got up really early. She packs the lunch and she starts walking over to the dock. And before she knows what's going on, she hears hundreds of fighter planes overhead. And before her very eyes, Japanese bombers and torpedo planes unleash hell onto the docks where Dave is working. And she wouldn't learn till later on that he was killed almost instantly, and she had basically watched his death unfold before her eyes that day at Pearl Harbor. So that was, of course, a huge tragedy for Minna, and it really broke her heart, and it took her a while to recover from that. But lo and behold, she found love again as she stayed in Hawaii, and she met a Hawaiian velvet painter who she also became engaged to. And then he died in a drowning accident in the ocean. And it's at this point, Minna tells me, I put two stakes in the ground. The first stake was that I'm done with men, can't do it anymore, this heart's hurting. But I am going to forevermore be known as, and she loved calling herself this, Minster the Spinster. So that's stake one. Stake two is, well, if I'm not gonna have a family, I'm not gonna marry, I'm not gonna have kids, then I'm gonna dedicate my life to becoming a family member to people of the world. And if I'm not gonna have kids, the kids of the world are gonna be my kids. So I wanna dedicate my life to helping others and volunteering. And I'm gonna take this broken heart and I'm gonna open it even wider instead of becoming bitter and cold. And so she dedicates her life to being a volunteer. And all she needs at this point is a steady salary and a home base. So she moves to LA where she becomes an x-ray technician to the stars, as she liked to tell me, because this was during the height of the 1950s Hollywood glam era. And she loved telling me the story of when John Wayne was on her x-ray table and gave her a little wink, and she'd always still blush about it. And she actually had articles published in medical journals. She went by Minnie at the time. And with her newfound freedom and salary, she begins saving every last penny, and she saves all of her vacation time so that she can travel the world with doctors and medical teams and provide high-quality healthcare to people that otherwise wouldn't have access to it. And this is Minna's life. She loves life, she loves volunteering, and she loves animals, basically in that order. And this is her dog, Buddy. And if Minna would greet you with a smile when you met her, Buddy would greet you by taking a chunk out of your ass, because he was not a nice dog. But Minna didn't care, she loved this little guy. And Minna just lived a life so deeply rooted in compassion. She was just compassion defined for me. And I love listening to her stories, and she loved telling them, and she essentially became a member of our family. We took her on big trips, and she attended vacations, and we loved her dearly. And she was even initiated as a member she was initiated as a member of my sorority, as an alumni initiate, and she was the heart of the chapter, and she was legend for all of her antics. And remember how I remember mentioned that compassion is a, the big component of that is fun? Well, Minna really, really liked to have fun. Like on the evening of her initiation, when she stayed up way past her bedtime so that she could go to a frat house and play beer pong with a pirate patch on her eye. So her stories inspired me and made me start to question if the profession I had chosen, graphic design, would have the same impact that hers had had, and also how might I weave my skills into volunteerism. So, and I'm really glad that I started to question being a graphic designer as I was looking back at my portfolio and I found this, and I have literally no clue what it is. And then I'm also really happy that Minna didn't go into art full time because she loved to paint and she gave me this. And this cat is terrifying. So there's that. All right, so the big lesson for this part is to listen. Little did my illustration professor know at the time, but he taught me more about listening than he had about illustration. And it was one of the first times I'd had to interview someone in a somewhat professional setting, and I just loved it. Because I also loved that he emphasized it wasn't about us, because a good interviewer almost fades into the background so that the interviewees can dive deeply into the mists of their memories and recall thoughts. And this is only part one of the listening lesson. We'll get to part two of the listening lesson in part two of the talk, so hold that thought. So listening to Minna had sparked something in me, but now that the spark was ignited, I wasn't sure what the next step was. So thus brings us to part two, taking action. And this is how I was able to transform sparks into a fire. And if Minna was the spark, then our local West Michigan design community was the fuel that set it ablaze. So this story starts with an email, and I'm just gonna pop open my email, and boop, I just sent you all an email, because it's that easy. I literally just sent you an email, right now. So we'll get to why that is important in a minute. So after I graduated, instead of focusing on graphic design, I focused on web design and what is now known as UX design at a company called the C2 Group. And for the first part of my career, I was so involved in just learning everything I could about that career path. I learned from so many amazing mentors, and I could give another talk just on mentorship because I value it so much. But I was keeping my head down, learning as much as I could, and still volunteering here and there, my time small bits, but it wasn't focused. And so I start reaching out to the local West Michigan design community, meeting more people, going to more events, when I hear about this thing called Design for Good. And I'm like the double rainbow guy. Like, whoa, Design for Good. Because it's an organization that's combining my passion for design with this desire to help. So in that moment, I think of Minna, and I think how she had incorporated her profession into volunteerism. And I sign up for the email newsletter as fast as I can, and I just wait to get something back. And because that team is so on top of it, I get something almost right away, and it's for Weekend Blitz. And for those of you who aren't familiar, Weekend Blitz is a three-day event where local professionals donate their time in design, development, marketing, branding, all different types of skills to local organizations and nonprofits. And so it's 2014, I fill out an application, and I just wait to hear back if I'm gonna make it on the team. And lo and behold, I'm paired with an organization called Homes of Hope. And I'm elected the team lead and working with a team of six other people. And it was an amazing weekend that I'll never forget. And I'm finally able to pair my profession with volunteerism like Minna had, in this instance as a project manager and a web designer and an illustrator. So this weekend introduces me to my now dear friends, Kate Hunt and Taylor Vandenhoek, and who are two talented designers and the big brains behind Weekend Blitz. And these ladies know how to get stuff done, as is proven by these amazing events that they facilitated. And I'm hooked, I gotta be a part of this org, I gotta make Minna proud of me, I gotta give back to this community who's been so welcoming and good to me, and it's everything that I've been looking for and didn't know existed. So I must have seemed like an absolutely crazy person that weekend because I was so excited. And Kate somehow must have not minded my odd behavior because about 2 or 3 months later, she asked me to take over for her as the director of design for good when her tenure was up. So I passed out and I woke up and I said yes. And for me, this is where I truly start to learn what it means to take action. And this is also where I learned how to really get stuff done. So this is Kate and Taylor. And I ramp onto this team of amazing women, and there's just no obstacle too big or too small for us. We just roll up our sleeves and we get stuff done. So you have an idea? Great, own it and get it done. So, oh, you want an ice cream truck at the next weekend blitz? Great, call good humor. Oh, you want a design thinking workshop for the nonprofits? Cool, you write the curriculum. Oh, you want to donate extra food to the local soup kitchen? Sweet, call Degagee, but get it done. Just own it and do it. So now that I'm learning how to take action, I want to weave in the listening component. So what's one of the things we do? First off, for the next weekend blitz, we ramp up the line of questioning during the team meet and greet so that when teams are meeting their organizations for the first time, they can understand deeply what that organization's goals are for the weekend. So Kate and Taylor had already set the standard for this crucial night, and we use that as a springboard to create creative briefs with detailed questionings to develop that solid understanding right off the bat. So here's lesson two of listening. Listen so that you can build the right thing and take the right action. Because if you're not listening to the people that you're going to act compassionately for, you might not be helping them at all. And you'll walk away with the warm fuzzies after the weekend is over, but they might be left with a mess. So think of that in the context of a 3-day weekend blitz, where if you haven't taken the time up front to understand who you're building for and what you're going to build and how to manage scope for that, then you're gonna spend all that time designing, developing, and building the wrong thing. So, and all that compassionate action will have been for naught. So, now that I'm learning how to listen better and take action, this spirals into other areas of my life. And in particular, on one morning, I'm at the factory participating in Coffee with Creators with my friend, Christy Ennis Clute. And Christy is the director of UX at Visual Hero. And at the time, both of our companies are hiring designers. And this is the moment that Ladies at UX Grand Rapids is born. And I wanted to demonstrate how easy it was to make this happen. So I've written a little play for you. And oh, look, it's a Christy Ennis Clute in the wild. Let's have her join us up here for the play. Okay. All right. And action.
Hey, we're hiring. You know how odd it is that there's like no lady designers applying for this job?
Same. Where are the ladies at?
So you know, there's a thing called Ladies at UX. Have you heard of it?
Yeah.
Hey, you want to start that Ladies at UX for Grand Rapids?
Yeah. End scene.
Thank you.
So it's as simple as that. 15 minutes later, I had opened a Twitter account as Christy was driving back to work, created a Gmail addresses, bought ladies@uxgr.com. I send Christy the login credentials, and there it is. We're live. And what do you think we did for our first event? We listened. Because we wanted to create a fun, inclusive, and supportive community of women and men UX designers. And around 30 women attended our first event. Shout out to Julia, just want to put that there. We miss and love her. And this is a shot from the first meetup. And the entire morning was structured around gathering information about them through these placemats that we had made. And we wanted to know more about who we were creating the programming for. So more importantly, around the breakfast table, we made room for listening to their stories. And it's through this act of listening that we learn many things about our design community. And they had so many stories to tell about UX, about big wins, about struggles and concerns, and stories of laughter and of fun, because we had a lot of fun that morning. And after that first meeting, we took all the ideas and filtered them down to the ones that we felt would be most impactful. And we planned our calendar for the year. And it's a real testament to our West Michigan design community that our chapter becomes the largest, sorry, the fastest growing chapter, dramatic pause, in the world. Because there's literally chapters all over the world. So there's that. So we wouldn't understand the real impact, and someone may have outpaced us by now. I just want to say that out there too. But we wouldn't understand the real impact that all this listening and acting was doing until upon the day of our first birthday as an organization, we receive a message from one of our members, a fellow lady UX designer. And in it, she writes that she really struggles. She really values the energy that she receives from ladies at UX events, but she really struggles being that she's on the autistic spectrum. Going to social events is really stressful for her, but that ladies, that UX though is different, and I feel genuinely appreciated and accepted and encouraged, and never ever condescendingly. In fact, I feel happily obligated to pay it forward. I know you started Ladies at UX for this kind of effect on the community, and you succeeded. Happy birthday to us. And Christy and I, we cried real tears that day. Then we partied really hard. And this is the best birthday present we could have ever received. And it's the power of listening and acting. So listening, to wrap up this part, listening and ideas are the easy part. And ideas are important because they contain all of our hopes and our dreams. But I believe that true compassion lies in action and doing something. Because I challenge everyone to act on your ideas, your great ideas, and your compassionate ideas when you have them. Don't wait. So it doesn't have to be a huge action. Just start somewhere, like the email that I just sent you. Send that email to get the ball rolling, or text message a friend, or schedule a get-together, or mow your grandma's lawn. Whatever it is, just take an action. And don't let your ideas die on the vine. And remember, too, about that listening and that fun part. Which moves me into part three, where I'm going to talk about how I and all my fellow Adams how I and all my fellow Adams use listening and action to build compassion into custom software. So here at Atomic, it kind of all starts and ends with our values. They are what unite us as people. They support our success. They are the beacons that guide us when we're recovering from failure, and they make us unique as a company. And so here are the values. Own it, that's Carl, our CEO. Own it, give a shit, act transparently, share the pain, teach and learn, and think long term. So how does compassion factor into this? I think it's through living these values and through repeating cycles of listening and taking action that we're able to bake compassion right into the core of the software that we make. So I'm going to walk you through a project that we did here at Atomic called Green Path, and I'm going to try to highlight how we did some of that compassionate baking. So this is Green Path is an organization that helps people manage their finances through debt management programs, credit counseling, and more. And Atomic was hired to build Green Path's debt management program online portal. And the purpose was to enable participants to view progress and keep them motivated and to manage minor account details. So there was an existing portal already, but it only supported really basic user information, and there was a really, really high drop-off rate in the program because people couldn't track their progress. So this whole project revolves around debt and how to get out of it. And if you think about debt, aside from a debt of gratitude, debt really doesn't have a lot of positive connotations. It's scary, it keeps people up at night, it feels like a giant weight on your back, it's just all around bad vibes. So this project opened my eyes to the fact that so many of our friends and neighbors and family members are struggling and living with debt, and it's so stressful. And specifically, one in four Americans on average have $16,883 worth of just credit card debt. That excludes medical bills, student loans, and mortgages, whether you consider some of that like a mortgage of debt. But to help visualize this, one in every four of you at the seats got a little sign with a dollar amount on it. And I bet you thought, I was gonna bust an Oprah and award you that money. I'm here to tell you that I am. Just kidding. just want an excuse to put Oprah in. Okay, so raise those signs in the air if you can grab them really quickly. Oh boy, some numbers out there. So when you're in a when you're gathered in a public space next time, this is my husband. So when you're gathered in a public space next time, think for a minute about how many people might be affected like this with this type of stress in their life, and look at these numbers. These numbers are pulled from people that are on Green Path Debt Management programs. So stop and think about that for a minute. Thank you, sign people. So what I found was that also there's a real lack of compassion for people who have this credit card debt. People just assume, like, come on, man, just stop shopping. And, you know, stop buying things on QVC or, like, racking up your Nikes or buying 1,000 outfits for cats, which I don't think there's a problem with that. But it's through listening that I learned that that's just not the case. Impulsive shopping is a problem, but it's usually a symptom of a bigger problem, and it's far from the most common. The primary reasons that people incur that debt are unemployment, death in the family or medical emergency, and caring and responsibility for another person. So these aren't a pair of Nikes. This is big, heavy, emotional stuff. And I'm going to quickly run you through the process that we took with Green Path to start weaving some of that compassion in during our research, design, and planning phase of the project. So this is 5 months of work bundled into 5 minutes. So bear with me and hold on to your butts. All right. So this project began, like most of ours do, with a discovery session, and during which we discuss user and business goals and set expectations and set we build a business model canvas. We use like a forest of trees worth of post-it notes and dive into analyzing current systems and many other exercises. And we also build proto-personas. And these are personas that are not yet validated, meaning they're built based off of assumptions, and we go further after this. We invite user advocates to join our team. And a user advocate is the end user of the product that we're building, and we ramp them right into the creation of the project from the very start. So right off the bat, we're getting valid user information. So because in order to truly understand users, you gotta meet the real thing. So fortunately, GreenPath had this amazing account of, it's a closed Facebook group with about 1,100 of their program participants who are highly active on this Facebook group and can't wait to help out and wanna be a part of building this thing. So one example of a document, so we've just listened and now we're taking action and now we're starting to synthesize those materials. And one of the documents that we make is called a mini brief. And this goes with us from the, basically like the week after we have started the project. It comes with us everywhere we go in the project after, because it always keeps us aligned on what our goals are and our design principles. And most importantly, it keeps these important people front of mind all the time so that we're always building for them and not for us. So we begin to validate our personas and learn from real people. And it's at this point that I receive from GreenPath the single best client-given document I've ever had, I've ever been given. And it is the data from a weekly journal tracked over many, many, many months of hundreds of program participants and their thoughts on their progress in the program. And they're pouring their hopes and their dreams and their fears and their struggles into these journal entries. And it's at this point that one of only four times I start ugly crying at work. And because these stories are so raw and real, and I just want to help these people get out of debt. So we go to the call center and we shadow call center agents who are setting up people on these debt management programs, and we hear these amazing stories of struggle and struggle that they kept going and they're trying and they know that they have this debt and they want to get out of it. And it's here I also meet the call center agent I sat with, Sarah, who's one of the most amazing, empathetic people I've ever met, and she reminds me of Minna. And they define compassion, these people, because they're not judgmental, they're caring, and all this time I'm sitting here listening to her to take these calls, and she's saying, we're here for you, we can do this together, you got this, it's gonna be okay, we're gonna work together. And I can tell that the people are really, really appreciative of this. So we've listened, and now we take action again, and we start sketching with team members and call center agents and program participants and synthesizing all this information that we're learning. And we also do a card sorting activity with call center agents and programming participants to learn what is it you want out of this portal, what's going to help you. And they tell us, we learn three things. When will I pay off my debt? When is my next payment? And do I have any tasks to complete? Those are the top three things they want to know on this portal, amongst other things. But these are the most important. So we synthesize that information into whiteboard sketches, and what do you know? What shows up? How long do I have to go? When's my next payment? And what are my tasks? So we take all that, we synthesize that into high fidelity prototype, and now we're taking action again, and we're gonna test this prototype so we can start, again, getting more feedback. So you're starting to see this cycle of listening, action, making something, getting validation from real people. So it's here we also start to incorporate some of Sarah's language. Go forth and conquer. Let's do this. Because her voice is so important in this. And we host a brand workshop, a brand experience workshop for the whole team, and we define our core brand values. And we determine them to be simple, motivating, personal, and calm. And this is the balm to the three most written words in the program participant journal, aside from the AI. Hard, stressed, and struggling. So then we go from there and we build out design concepts based off of those concepts. Calm, motivating, simple, personalized, and the team decides that they want to choose motivating. This is really important to them. So now we really kick off the compassion by adding in participant-generated quotes at the top, into their journals, background images that update as their journey continues through, and the landscape updates depending on where they're at in their progress. Because these program participants want a safe, encouraging space, because think about what it's like not having this space. It's creditors calling on you on the phone, attacking you, judging you, being rude. It's not fun. So this needs to be a haven for them. So we put helpful chat tools in where we literally say, we're here for you. And this connects them directly to Sarah's team. So anytime there's a friend there. And after doing multiple interviews, we learn from program participants and job shadows and things that the participants want to celebrate their wins and they want to celebrate their life in a personalized way. So we set up personalized and automated milestones so that they can track their progress and celebrate the big wins that mean something to them. And don't forget the basics. Program participants can now see when their payments will be made, and they know exactly how much has been paid and how much is left to go. So we send out quick Facebook tests all this time to get hype started on the new design and obtain feedback, and people are really fast to respond. It's so much fun. And they give us gems like this to consider too. He's saying this one, I like this one. I'm a big person though, and I'm afraid it might be hard to click on some of these smaller buttons. So then, all right, sweet, we've listened to you, and now we're gonna take action and whip up an Envision prototype that has big buttons and little buttons. And we learn that they're actually cool with the little buttons, so we go with the little buttons, because this isn't just about how the portal makes you feel, you have to actually be able to physically use it too. So there's parts of that as well, so we're listening for that. And if you've done it right, and you've listened to all the user advocates, and you've acted upon what you've learned, when you get into advanced user testing prior to launch, you hear things like this. When does this launch? I'm just so motivated. And I kid you not, GreenPath thought that I paid the user testers to say that. They were like, you paid them, right? And I was like, no. And then they're like, but really? It's like, no. So after that, the dev team at Atomic just completely rocks it out and builds this amazing thing in conjunction with the design, me as a designer, and GreenPath and the user advocates, and because it's we as a team, it's not just Atomic. And after we launch, we start receiving messages on that Facebook group. Nope, we don't, it's right here. The new portal is awesome. I just logged in and only 2 months we're down $2,600. Praying my credit score increase stays that way. So we must have done something right, but as we know, software is never over. So we'll probably keep iterating on this and making it better and better for them. So for the designers out here, I build you just a really quick six-step thing. We're gonna zoom through it really quick. Find real users, listen to them, build on what you've learned, then give them what you've built, and listen again, redesign, and keep doing that forever. but do repeat, because it's important to always keep evolving as your users keep evolving. So if you're listening and recording, we're gonna wrap this all up with a nice big bow now. So if you're listening well and acting accordingly, then it shouldn't be about you. And if we hadn't taken the time to really listen up front to our Weekend Blitz organizations and just, we had just said, no, you know what, we're designers, we're gonna do what we feel is right, we would have walked away feeling awesome and our clients would have been worse off than when we started with them. And if I only build software for myself, then I can't be that upset when no one wants to use it but me. So I wrote a bumper sticker for this that says, say bye-bye ego and hello to other amigos. That's terrible. So here's the catch. All of this listening can be an action, can be really uncomfortable. Is it sometimes awkward to interview someone you don't know? Yeah. Can it be a real pain to haul 15 cases of water up 5 flights of stairs in a heat wave when the power goes out during Weekend Blitz? Yeah. Is it not super fun to, no, it's not super fun to send thousands of emails on the weekends looking for sponsors for Design for Good? It's just not. And it can be really unpleasant to hear negative feedback on the hard work that you've done and something that you present to a user. But if you transform these doubts and criticisms into action instead, I promise you it will set you free. Because when you hear that users are struggling, don't be afraid to tear the whole thing down and start over. Because I know that in all of your amazing heads, you have 20 or 30 other brilliant ideas or more that are just waiting to be born. So don't get grumpy or blocked because that one idea doesn't work out. Instead, get creative and excited that your failure is about to lead you to the right solution, and have confidence in yourself that you can get to the right solution. So finally, listen to others so that it can spark something in you. And when you have that spark already, listen to others again so that you can act to take the right action. And then finally, just do the thing. Within each of you are amazing, compassionate ideas waiting for you to move your thumb to hit send or plant that seed or reach out to that loved one or to start a revolution, but just start. So to live a compassionate life, spark a fire within yourself, take action and own it, and share it with the world. So what's next? Where do y'all start? And I have some ideas for you. You could volunteer for Weekend Blitz or Give Camp in November, or we have Designs for Good's Halloween event where you can design costumes for kids in the Big Brother, Big Sister program. It's happening again next year. Or you could go to servegr.com and check out some volunteer opportunities, or maybe we could get some inspiration from above. Wow! I feel good. I would I feel good. I knew that I would. So good, so good. I got a year. Wow, I feel nice. The sugar is fine. I feel nice. The sugar is fine.